Steven Tyler. Welcome to Talk Asia.
Well, thank you so much.
You've been performing for what, 40 years? Man alive, you look great.
And being dragged behind the truck or living on the tail of a comet?
No, I mean, the amount of energy that you have, and you still are able to bring it on stage day after day, after all these years, how do you do it?
Well, you know, the band met in New England, and I was, my parents had a small resort up there, and I was put to work every summer. I mowed fields and dug ditches and put in water lines and rolled the tennis court and just did a ton of stuff. So I've got that country boy get up and go in me. So did Joe. We grew up around the lake, and Tom and Joey and Brad. And so we decided early on that we were going to we just wanted our big toe in the door, and that we just, that's all we needed. We were going to make it, and we're going to blow every band we played with off the map and off the stage. And so there was no MTV back then. We played everywhere we could. And we started in 91. By 98, we played every place in the United, every state in the United States, but Alaska and Hawaii eight times. And so, you know, that's it. We love to play. We love getting audiences off. I guess that's it.
What's interesting is that you're performers, but you're also singer-songwriters. And the songs that you've written have, you know, gone from generation to generation, that you know, grandmothers to young kids are still listening and they really appreciate it. What do you think it is about your music? Because when we look at, say, Sweet Emotion, written 1975 for yeah. Toys in the Attic, and today, if it's on the radio, people will listen and they'll sing to it as well, sing with it. What was it? What is it about your music that really is able to bridge any sort of generational divide?
I think a good lyric and a good melody. And when you put those together, it's just, there's magic. And, you know, radio loved us, thank God. You know, that's what making it means, that you get embraced by. And it becomes the backdrop of a year, 2 years. My high school, which is 4 years, and it became that. And again, I don't know what to say. We were lucky. We hit on a good chorus. Don't bore us, get to the chorus. I remember Tom playing that doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo, and I just went, sweet emotion. It spread out that line, that word, those group of words, real nice, and it was. It just happened to work, you know, and the chorus of Dream On. And
you were 17 when you wrote that, right? Dream On? You were 17 when you wrote Dream On.
There were bits and pieces that I wrote when I was 16 and then 18. And by 20, I had the shell of the song. And when the band got together, we were a couple of songs short. So I wrote Make It for that album. I wrote One Way Street. And I finished Dream On. So. Hey, the lean years, right? We got a contract with Columbia.
Yeah, Clive Davis noticed you guys.
Right? Oh my God, what are we gonna do for songs? And so, what's the mother invention? The mother
necessity.
Of invention is freaking out that you got your big toe stuck in the door. and you're screaming and someone says, scream something other than a scream. So I decided to put some lyrics to it.
Interesting thing about being in a band, in a huge band like Aerosmith, is that you become known as Aerosmith. How difficult was it, is it, to just be Steven?
Oh, it's hard. You know, I get, when I text my kids, I read it back, I go, whoa. Because I'm out here in on tour mode, and I kind of live like that in my mind. I kind of live spontaneously from moment to moment. But when you're like that with your kids, you pay the price big. If you don't think that thought out first, you're going to get flambéed.
What kind of a dad are you?
I'm not so good because I'm not around dad, but I'm a loving dad. Mm-hmm. I get them. They get me. They've seen me on stage. They know my passion. But they keep me in place. I've had some problems in life where I got caught up in drugs and caught up in booze and caught up in relationships of anger, and they've sensed it, you know.
I read that you come from a very musical family. Is it true that your dad was a classical pianist? Mm-hmm. Your grandpa and uncle as well were classical musicians as well. So it's in your DNA. You had no choice but to become a musician. That's the sense.
You know, I saw a brochure from 1912 of my family, the Tallarico brothers, that one played cello, one played viola. One played piano, one played guitar, and they'd get on a train, because that's all there was back then, and play in these fabulous hotels. These guys were on tour. They left their significant others and went on tour. Did they have relationships with strange ladies in the lobby? You bet your ass. Did they see a side of life that was way different than that mundane living in New York City, working 9 to 5? Yeah. They were gypsies, and my band, we were that.
But performing is in your blood,
yes.
Literally.
Oh, it is.
What do you remember about your dad's music? What do you remember feeling about it?
I remember growing up under the piano as young as, like, I remember when I was, I don't remember how old I was, but I could just finally reach, it was, my father had a baby grand in the living room of this apartment, and the living room was, I think it was 9 feet by 14 feet. That was the living room, 9 feet. This was in the Bronx. And I lived under my father's piano, and when I could finally stand up and reach the bottom, which is the soundboard, I would put my fingers on it and lift myself up like a monkey. I'd play. And I remember looking up and grabbing the soundboard, and I pulled this inch of dust down that went into my eyes, and I couldn't see, but that was the fairy dust of notes that my father played. That was the grandness of the grand piano. That was the dust of all time, of Debussy and Brahms and Bach and Beethoven. That was my induction into the pain of music, if you will. Whatever I make it is, I really got some dust in my eyes, but I prefer to think of it as, that's how I grew up. I listened to him practicing every day for 2 hours, every day, until I was 5. So unbeknownst to me, I was sprinkled the Debussy, the Beethoven, so those notes that Joe Perry, when I met him, he was playing hard bar chords of these English bands that I loved and played in all of my bands. I thought, if the band knows this, I can bring the dream on, or I can bring some sort of a melodic something, to it. And therein is the magic.
There's something wrong with the world today. I don't know what it is. Something's wrong with our eyes. We're seeing things in a different way, and God knows it ain't his. It sure ain't no surprise. We're living on the edge.
You've had a lot of success, and creativity and success does come at a price. I read that, I understand that you've gone through rehab 8 times. How dark were those times? How dark did it get for you?
Here's what happens. You have this dream to be in a band. You get a bunch of guys together. You're making something out of nothing, and it's so intoxicating that when you smoke a joint after you listen back, it's the same thing. It's the same, that euphoric recall that a drug gives you is the same thing that listening to the Toys in the Attic record back. It's like, what? So when I sing it on stage, I relive that. I can do that through my music. But, a lot of people like to smoke pot, and it gets them out of everyday humdrum and the pain of the anxiety of having to argue with their boss or live with their mother or whatever. It's the great, it clears the table. But as everybody knows, you just wind up wanting to get more and not dealing with the problem at hand.
Last question. What do you think is the anthem to your life? Would it be Living on the Edge or I Don't Want to Miss a Thing?
That's why I live on the edge. Because I don't want to miss a thing. So therein is the passion and energy of little Stevie following the brook to see what's under that rock. I live for that passion so I can write the third verse of the song Joe and I haven't written yet. It's just who I am.
It's a pleasure to meet you, Steven Teller. Thank you so much for
your time. I love you for this.